Welcome to the Council on Foreign Relations State and Local Officials webinar. I'm Irina Faskianis, Vice President for the National Program and Outreach here at CFR. We're delighted to have participants from 49 states and U.S. territories for today's conversation, which is on the record. CFR is an independent and nonpartisan membership organization, think tank, publisher, and educational institution focusing on U.S. foreign and domestic policy. CFR is also the publisher of Foreign Affairs magazine. And as always, CFR takes no institutional positions on matters of policy. Through our state and local officials initiative, CFR serves as a resource on international issues affecting the priorities and agendas of state and local governments by providing analysis on a wide range of policy topics. For today's discussion, we are going to be talking about building a competitive U.S. workforce, and we have an amazing panel of speakers today. Bo Machayo is the Director of U.S. Government and Public Affairs at Micron Technology. He has a decade of experience as a public policy and public engagement advisor at the local, state, and federal levels of U.S. government, and has had a number of positions, including in the office of Virginia Senator Mark Warner, Loudoun County's Board of Supervisors, and in the Obama administration. David Shahoulian is the Director of Workforce Policy and Government Affairs at Intel Corporation. Previously, he worked at the Department of Homeland Security on border immigration policy. He's also served on the House Judiciary Committee for over 10 years. Dr. Rebecca Shearman is the Program Director for Technology, Innovation, and Partnerships at the National Science Foundation. Previously, she was an assistant professor in the biology department at Framingham State University. And holds a PhD in evolution and developmental biology from the University of Chicago. We also will be joined by Abby Ilumoka, who currently serves as a program director for engineering education in the Division of Undergraduate Education at NSF. And prior to that, she was a professor of electrical and computer engineering at the University of Hartford in Connecticut. And finally, I'm happy to introduce Sherry Van Sloan, who is the National Intelligence Fellow at CFR. Previously, she served as a Deputy Assistant Director of National Intelligence for Human Capital at the Office of the Director of National Intelligence for 9 years. And she's also held various positions with the National Security Agency and served in the U.S. Army as a signals analyst for 8 years. Sherry's going to be moderating this conversation. She brought this great panel together and can talk a little bit about her research and basically the provisions for state and local governments in the CHIPS and Science Act. We will then open it up for questions and turn to all of you. Again, this is a forum where we can share best practices, so we do want to hear from you. You can either write your question or raise your hand when we get there. So Sherry, over to you to take it away.
Thanks so much, Irina, and thanks to you and your staff for putting this webinar together. I really feel lucky to be here today. I want to say thanks to Becky, Bo, David, and Abby for being here as well. I know your schedules are busy, so we really appreciate you taking the time out of your day. And then I want to thank all of you who joined today. I think it's great to have all of us here to talk about this important topic. So a little context, my last few assignments in the intelligence community revolved around building talent pipelines to meet the emerging demands of intelligence work. So my time here at CFR, I've spent some time looking into the implementation of the CHIPS and Science Act, specifically the human capital aspect of the act. My focus has really been around the need to build semiconductor manufacturing talent. But to be clear, the CHIPS and Science Act covers many other STEM workforce advancements and future technologies, from AI to biotechnology to quantum computing. So today we have Becky and Abby here from NSF to share about the broader reach the CHIPS and Science Act gave the NSF regarding cultivating workforce, and then Bo and David to dive into some of the semiconductor manufacturing perspective around talent. So looking forward to this, and I think we're gonna kick it off with going to Becky and Abby at the NSF. Let me start here and say the NSF has been involved in promoting science for many decades. It's been active in supporting workforce development through your Directorate of STEM Education. And what the CHIPS Act legislation did was create the Director of Technology, Innovation, and Partnerships. And one of those new programs under that new directorate is the Experiential Learning for Emerging and Novel Technologies, which is the excellent program. which I think, Becky, you helped to create that program. So we're glad you're here. So can one of you share how the Excellent Program works, the timelines you've laid out, and the impact you're hoping to see over time? And then specifically, maybe you could focus a little bit for a minute on the semiconductor workforce specifically and how the Excellent Program will help to build this much needed body of talent for the US.
Sure, Sherry. Happy to jump in. You're correct. I was involved in the development of the Excellent Program, and we are super excited about it. It's so TIP is, which is the acronym of our new directorate, just celebrated its first birthday at very end of the spring, and we're really in just our first funding cycle of Excellent. You read out the full acronym, right? So this is really centered around experiential learning. And we've named emerging and novel technologies. So emerging technologies really are those technologies that we, you know, we point to the CHIPS and Science Act and say that's, you know, what we're interested in funding. But we did keep it kind of open. So novel technologies, right? We are kind of allowing the community to tell us, look, this may not fall precisely in the line of these emerging technologies, but we need to be building a workforce that can do X, Y, and Z. And we specifically developed this program with a few things in mind. We need to build a workforce that is nimble in its ability to get training as expertise evolves, as our technologies evolve. And we've got to engage all Americans in the STEM enterprise, if they're interested in being in the STEM enterprise. For us to be really competitive, everyone needs to have access to a good STEM education. And then we also built it around the fact that we felt like we really need to be bringing organizations across different sectors together to do this correctly, right? We need to have those experts in education, but we also need to have those industry partners who understand the need of the industry and the needs of the specific company. So the program is really designed to address those things. It's very broad. So we allow the applicant, who can be from academia, they can be from the private sector, they can be nonprofits. We're really trying to reach everybody here. They can say, this is the population we're trying to reach. So maybe it's, you know, middle school, high school students, maybe it's adult learners, at any point in their educational career, and trying to get them hands-on experience that's going to give them some credential, expose them to something so that they, if they choose, can kind of be on that educational path towards a good paying job in an emerging tech field. And of course, the semiconductor industry is central to that, right? There, we don't have a specific call out to semiconductors, but we highlight it as one of the emerging technologies.
And Becky, thank you. So can you share a little bit more with the audience about like how they would go about engaging with you on a proposal? What is the process that folks do that? I know you have calls, but can you explain that a little bit about how a call goes out and then what that looks like once it closes?
Absolutely. So we have a solicitation out, and if I'm allowed to drop something into the chat, I'm happy to share the link and you can go right to it. And we have deadlines. In fact, our next deadline is September 14th. So if anyone's really interested and has nothing to do in the next month, you can take a look at the solicitation and consider applying for the program. It outlines, the solicitation will outline everything you need to do, but basically you're writing up a proposal, submitting it through our standard process at NSF through a site called research.gov. And then your proposal goes through a merit review process where we bring in experts from the community that will include people with the expertise in education, expertise in industry. You know, we try to have a very broad cross-sector expertise represented on that panel, and they review all the proposals and give us recommendations and feedback around where we should make our funding decisions. The best thing to do, if you go to that solicitation, there are links on that first page to to an inbox and to program officers that you can reach out to, a good place to start is just reaching out to them and trying to connect and have an initial conversation.
Thank you. And if I recall, your first grant announcement will be announced soon, right? And then
very soon.
The call in September will be announced later this year or early next year. Super. Okay. Thank you very much, Becky. Bo, let's move to you. And, you know, really kind of diving into semiconductors specifically. You know, your role allows you to see kind of across Micron and how it's working with partners to build the talent pipeline that you all need for your existing locations and where you're also expanding at new locations across the country. Can you share a little bit about how Micron has responded to the passing of the CHIPS Act legislation, specifically here in New York, and how you're tracking that talent pipeline gaps at all levels of the manufacturing life cycle?
Yep. Thanks, Sherry, for that question. And it's great to be a part of this discussion. Per, you know, your conversation, we're happy. Micron, thanks to the CHIPS and Science Act, and also thanks to the incentives from the, you know, states and localities, we were able to make investments of, you know, in New York of $100 billion over the course of the next couple of decades. And a big part of that is around how we can address the talent pipeline needs. About, you know, we'll have 9,000 direct jobs and over 40,000 indirect jobs due to economic activity that will happen in the Central New York region. But we know that all those, you know, that talent won't be able to come directly from Central New York, that will it'll have to be a whole of New York approach, but also a regional approach across the Northeast. And so specifically in New York, we've, you know, been able to, you know, establish partnerships from what we're calling the K through gray level, really making sure that from K through 12, we're doing interactive activities and sponsoring what we call CHIP camps that are unique to Micron, and we're able to make sure that we are, you know, engaging young K through eight, you know, students to be able to really understand the jobs that are available in the semiconductor industry. Another thing that we're doing specifically in New York is really working on kind of both curriculum development and how we can partner with schools. As a part of our announcement, we made a commitment to doing $10 million into the STEAM school, which is a local initiative that will focus on both career or both technical kind of education, but also kind of an engineering pathway to assure that, you know, we can get students interested in the semiconductor industry early on. We're also, you know, about half those jobs are going to be technician jobs and the other half will be engineering jobs. So how we're partnering with, you know, local building trades unions through our PLA to make sure that we're educating folks, establishing certificate programs so that we can make sure that folks who are looking to transition to the semiconductor industry, thanks to the investment that we're making there, how can folks be part of the Micron experience? And then also, how are we doing that with community colleges and also higher ed institutions as well? And so we've partnered with the SUNY system in New York and also the CUNY system in New York to make sure that we're building the pipeline from a community college there, particularly investing in creating clean rooms at Onondaga Community College and then utilizing the existing clean rooms across the state. We're also established a couple of regional networks for New York, especially the Northeast University Semiconductor Network, to really make sure that we're taking you know, what individual community colleges and higher ed institutions have to be able to make sure that we're addressing those gaps. You know, these are kind of examples of ways. And as a matter of fact, earlier this week, when I was in Central New York, we also were able to partner with the local museum, Science and Technology Museum in Central New York, to create a semiconductor exhibit so that kids from K through 12 could actually be able to understand what a semiconductor is, what a memory chip is, and there are multiple different ways and avenues to be able to attract talent, to be able to come and to meet the gaps that we have throughout the semiconductor industry. And so those are just a couple of ways in which we're looking to build partners and to address some of the needs that we'll have in New York.
Thanks, Bill. It's fantastic. David, I'm going to turn to you now. I just got back from Portland, Oregon last week, where I was able to get a tour of the Intel fab and their innovation center. And it was really incredible to see firsthand the different kinds of talent needed to make this industry possible. Can you share a little bit about the makeup of Intel's workforce? I think many people will be surprised that the bulk of it really isn't PhDs, but how you're building efforts for a talent pipeline needed for your major investment in Ohio specifically. I know that's a huge one for you guys. I know the Ohio State University is kind of the hub of that consortium there, but which makes me very proud. I'm a Buckeye. But can you talk a little bit about that and what's happening there?
Sure, happy to do that. So first of all, thank you for having me. It is a pleasure to be here. Second, like Bo mentioned, you know, we're excited about the opportunity the CHIPS and Science Act provides. And, you know, because of that and the incentives that we're getting from the federal government and the state governments, you know, we are right now building, expanding all of our sites and building a new greenfield site in Ohio. On your first question, yes, people are generally surprised to hear about the makeup of our manufacturing workforce. Summarize it really quickly, right? Each of our fabs is generally around 1,500 positions that we create for that fab. About 60 to 70% of those jobs are for semiconductor technicians. These are individuals that can have an associate's degree, but in some cases, we don't even require that. A certificate would do. And in some cases, you know, we hire people with even less than that to be technicians. These are people that oversee and troubleshoot the manufacturing process. And then all of the support systems like the electrical, water, gas, and air filtration systems that, you know, support manufacturing operations. So that's the bulk of the jobs that we will be creating with our new factories. The remainder is about 20 to 25%, you know, individuals with bachelor's degree in electrical engineering, computer science, and then it's about, you know, somewhere between 5 and 10% individuals with advanced degrees. I will just want to say, just add a little caveat for Oregon, right? Because Oregon is a location where we do manufacture, but we also develop our manufacturing technology. There we do, you know, there is a higher ratio of PhDs. So there, you know, there are more advanced degree folks. Second, with respect to Ohio, look, we're very excited about the work that we're doing there. One of the reasons we chose Ohio as a site was because of the great educational system that already existed there and their history with advanced manufacturing. When we announced that we were going to be building there, we immediately committed $50 million into sort of, you know, expanding that education ecosystem that already exists. And that's, you know, modernizing the curricula, creating modules that are semiconductor specific, providing semiconductor manufacturing equipment, helping build clean rooms. These are all the things that are necessary to train individuals and give them, you know, hands-on training in our industry. So we've already awarded $17.7 million of that. That has gone to 8 collaborations involving almost 80 schools across the entire state of Ohio. We're really proud of that effort. One of them, just to give you two examples, one of them is being led by Columbus State Community College. They're working with every other community college system in the state of Ohio to create semiconductor technician curricula with shared credits, right, that can be shared across all of the different institutions. There's another one that's being led by the Ohio State University. I should have said the Ohio State University. Yeah, forgive me for that. Right, they're partnering with 9 other universities to create an education and research center for the semiconductor industry to lead on innovation and education. So, you know, these are the things that are necessary, you know, to create the education ecosystem that will help not only us, but our suppliers, and then other semiconductor companies across the country.
So do you think that what you're doing in Ohio, you've got quite the consortium like you just talked about, is that going to be enough to be able to source the talent pipeline for that fab and the outlying things that are going to happen around that fab in Ohio? Or is there ways that other you're going to reach into other areas, like Bo mentioned, a regional approach to that space in Ohio?
Yeah, so that is, you know, that is a regional approach in the sense that we've reached out to all of Ohio. We also have interest from other universities in the rest, you know, the remainder of the region, Purdue, Michigan, you know, other universities in the Midwest. What we've asked is for them to help partner with the Ohio universities, and, you know, we're working on trying to build those partnerships and those collaborations. You know, we've also, you know, collaborated with NSF, right? So, you know, with NSF got $200 million to build out the education ecosystem. You know, we know Micron partnered and put some money on the table. We did as well. You know, we matched $50 million in funding to create a $100 million partnership with NSF to sort of also bring those opportunities nationwide to any school, not just ones where we're operating. So NSF has already rolled out two programs with that funding. And, you know, we anticipate they will be rolling out more this year. And, you know, schools anywhere in the country will be able to apply for that funding.
Great. That's fantastic. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dave. That's very helpful, I think, for the audience today. Becky, if we can come back to you or Abby, it seems to me that if the U.S. wants to be a leader in this industry for semiconductors specifically, it's going to take a village, right? I mean, how do we best prepare the partnerships between private sector, academia, and community organizations to really find ways to bring exposure to this kind of work? I know Micron and Intel are doing their great work, but is there anything that NSF is doing kind of to get this message out and get excitement built around this industry?
So I'll start, but then I really do want to invite Abby to join me and add anything she may have. She's sits in a different place than I do at NSF. I can at least speak from TIPS Directorate. I know we've been doing a lot. So TIP stands for Technology, Innovation, and Partnerships. And we are very much interested in really trying to move emerging tech innovations into practice, kind of at speed, at scale. And a big part of that includes making sure we're thinking about the workforce needed to do that successfully, right? And so everything that's coming out of TIP is really emphasizing these partnerships. So even when it comes to workforce development, we feel like we're not going to be able to do this well unless we're really engaging all the people who bring some sort of expertise to it. And I think when you listen to David and Bo talk about what they're doing, right, they're talking about doing this in partnership, in collaboration. And, you know, the Excellent Program in particular is, so I guess let me start by saying, with TIP being a new directorate and all the attention that has brought, we're trying to bring these different sectors who maybe aren't used to talking with each other into the same room. And all of our programs that are coming out are doing that. And Excellent is no exception there. And we are trying to get the community thinking beyond, although, you know, Intel and Micron are absolutely central to this success, but we're trying to get the as is, you know, the Ohio State, but we also recognize that if we want to educate the domestic workforce, there's a lot of other organizations that could bring real value. So we are being very intentional about reaching out to community organizations, to nonprofits that are thinking a lot about reaching specific communities to get folks who would never consider themselves someone who would be in this space, have a job, you know, in a semiconductor manufacturing plant working for Intel, right? It wouldn't occur to them that that's something that they would do. We're trying to create those pathways to reach out and give them some initial exposure and bring them into the fold so the opportunities are there for them if they want them. And we're also including those industry partners and the large universities, but we think that the more different perspectives we can get together in a room, the better we're gonna be able to diversify the pathways and reduce the barriers to those jobs. And that's what Excellent is really trying to do. And like I said, I'd love to give Abby an opportunity to share anything from her perspective at NSF if she wants.
Thank you, Rebecca. I agree with everything Rebecca has said. What I would like to add is that in addition to ensuring that the content is being provided and experiential learning is being provided to students across the spectrum of academic levels, we in the Education Directorate are focused on ensuring that evidence-based teaching and learning practices are brought into the classrooms. We want to ensure that the right environments are available to students, the right kinds of support for learning, right kinds of assessment, And so we have partnered with TIP on some innovative opportunities known as DCLs, Dear Colleague Letters. These are opportunities that bring together programs in the Education Directorate and programs in the TIP Directorate to fund investigators that are focused on not just teaching, in the case of semiconductors, how to design chips, but also how to teach the design of chips. Now, I taught the design of chips for 20 years before I joined NSF, so I know exactly how challenging that is. You're designing structures that you can't see, essentially, and you're having to refine and redesign to ensure that they work, to test and ensure that they work. And so in the Education Directorate, we have held a number of events to get the public excited about chip design and chip design education. In May, we had a workshop to which we invited folks in academia, all the way from universities to kindergarten. And we had a wonderful attendance. Over 300 people showed up for the workshop. It was a two-day workshop. And folks were invited to brainstorm on how to teach microelectronics at all levels. So a lot of interesting information came out of that. We had participants from industry, Intel, Micron, and so forth. We had participants from government and from academia. So that was a very successful event. We have a second webinar on the 8th of August along the same lines. So we have currently two DCLs, and I'll put the links in the chat. Dear Colleague Letters, one is called Advancing Microelectronics Education, which looks at ways in which you can actually teach this stuff to folks who don't have the extensive math and physics and chemistry background. The second thing we're doing is making sure that we integrate these opportunities with existing programs in the Education Directorate. For example, the IEUS program is Improving Undergraduate STEM Education. It is a well-established program in the directorate, and it looks at innovations for teaching and learning in STEM in general. Now, by bringing this program into play with the excellent program, then we attract investigators that have an interest, not just in the content, the chip design, but also in how to teach the chip design. Now that confluence brings up very exciting, very interesting proposals on ways in which you can present this material to folks who are not experts at all or not in the domain. So I hope that answers your question on how to get folks excited. We have a couple of workshops and webinars scheduled going forward that will draw in participants from all over the country. And we generally keep pretty good notes on what goes on at those workshops, the kinds of questions, the kinds of ideas that are shared, and move forward on those to help the community grow.
That's fantastic. Thank you very much. It's really helpful. If you could put those things in the links in the chat, that would be fantastic for the folks listening in today. Irina, it's 3:30. Do you want me to turn this over to you for Q&A?
Yes, I think that would be great. Let's go to all of you now for questions. You can either write your question in the Q&A box. If you do that, please include your affiliation, or you can raise your hand and I'll recognize you, and then you can ask your question. And don't be shy. We really want to hear from you. Right now, we have no questions, which I think people are just collecting their thoughts. So Sherry, if you have another question while people are thinking about what they want to ask.
Go ahead.
We do have one question. Raised hand from Usha Reddy. And if you could identify yourself and unmute yourself. And you're still muted. There you go.
Thank you. So my name is, I'm from Kansas. I'm Senator Yusha Reddy, but also a public school teacher, elementary school. And I also am part of several nonprofits which advocate for STEM learning, especially for our young women and girls. So I want to know, can anybody apply for these NSF grants? Do you have to be a doctorate or affiliated with a university? Can it be a teacher? Can it be a nonprofit organization? Who is eligible for these types of grants?
Sherry, can I just jump in?
Yeah, please do, Becky.
Okay. So that is a great question. I'm so glad that you asked that. So I guess in reality, it depends. NSF historically, you know, makes grants to academic institutions. We are trying to change that quite a bit. So for a lot of our funding opportunities, you can be something other than an academic institution to submit, but you would have to look at the eligibility, right? So some types of organizations are not eligible. For example, the federal government can apply for an NSF grant, right? But nonprofits, some local government offices, if they're related to education, can apply for these funding opportunities. So those opportunities definitely exist. And if there's a program that you're specifically interested in, I would encourage you to reach out to a program officer associated with that program. And if you can sort of Google the program, if you happen to know it off, if you're familiar with the program, it'll direct you to a contact.
Fantastic. Let's go next to the raised hand from Mayor Melissa Blaustein.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for a great session. I really appreciate it. And actually, Sherry, I was so happy to see higher grades of intelligence. I'm coming to you from the Naval Postgraduate School. I'm a student at CHDS right now, the master program for local governments on homeland security. And in that vein, I'm wondering, I'm from a smaller municipality. Sausalito is quite small, but very well known. And we don't often think about the issues of how we can attract hiring for these types of industries. But I'd love to hear maybe from Bo and David a little bit about what you're seeing smaller communities or policies do to attract these type of people, or perhaps if remote working is being qualified or considered for folks who want to pursue a career in chips and semiconductors. And any advice any of you have as well for smaller local governments to attract a conversation around this type of topic. Thanks again for your time. Really appreciate it.
Bo, do you want to take that first? And then David, if you want to chime in, that'd be great.
Yeah, no, I think so. We are investing in, you know, Boise and in central New York and in Onondaga County, but in a small town called Clay. And one of the things that we found successful, and I'll focus on the New York model, was working with the state and the locality to come up with something called a community investment framework. So it was a partnership between Micron, the state, and the locality to really look at how are we investing in things that the community needs, everything from housing to workforce to childcare, and really kind of focusing on what those barriers to entry were to ensure that folks could be able to work in the semiconductor network. And then also using that as a model to say, what will we be able to do similar to that model in Boise, and how do we make sure it's a whole state approach and also kind of a regional approach to invest in these barriers to entry to the semiconductor network, and how can Micron play their role in that? And so in New York in particular, we decided to invest $250 million of that $500 million and then committing to raising the other 150, and the state put in 100, and the locality also put in some of those dollars to ensure that we meet those needs and those barriers, and to be able to make sure that over the course of the next couple of decades, as we implement our project, that we are providing and addressing, whether that's a skills gap or a barriers to a workforce gap, or providing or investing in childcare or whatnot, to make sure that we're able to attract talent from across the area. And then also making sure to kind of work with our localities and other localities that are surrounding to make sure that we're also partnering with them to do the exact same thing and to replicate that model. And that's something that we've found successful, is that just intentional partnership to make sure that we are building up that next generation of workforce to have those skills that are necessary. But I'll turn it over to David to talk a little bit about what Intel's doing.
Yeah, thanks, Bo. I don't want to speak for Micron. I assume this is also true, right? We sort of take a both and approach to building up the education ecosystem across the country, right? I mean, we have national partnerships, like Micron, Intel partnered with NSF. We put in money along with government money to create, grant opportunities for schools across the country to apply for if they, wanted to get into the semiconductor space or they wanted to, up their game in that space. And then both companies, right, we also have regional partnerships, right, particularly in the communities in which we, build facilities, we dedicate a lot of our effort, partly because, the reality is with technicians, community colleges are only going to build technician programs for their communities if there are facilities nearby where their community members can work. You don't see community colleges far from semiconductor spaces actually bringing on semiconductor programs, if there isn't a job anywhere in that area for the community members who go to that school. So that is why we work really closely with the local community colleges in Oregon, Arizona, New Mexico, now in Ohio, to build programs near the facilities. That said, we are happy to share the certificate programs, the curricula, the associate degree program curricula with any community college that wants to build that. I would say we're also partners with the American Semiconductor Academy, right, which is along with the SEMI Foundation is working to try to build curricula that is shared across all universities, so that again universities and community colleges and other educational institutions can basically start or upgrade their semiconductor related curricula much more easily. So I just want to say that there are both opportunities near where we are and national opportunities as well.
Fantastic. So we have a written question from Sean Niedorf. What is the career path for a person who comes in as a semiconductor processing technician? What does a career in semiconductors look like for a person with an associate's or less education? And then a related comment question from Allison Hicks, who is the mayor of Mountain View, a Silicon Valley city and home of Google headquarters. The big thing I hear from constituents regarding barriers to jobs is getting a first job after getting an engineering degree. People tell me there are 100 or more applicants for many, if not most jobs, and they can barely even get interviews. They feel their resumes are being auto-screened out if they don't have a degree from Stanford, Berkeley, et cetera. So they rarely make it to even the first step of the hiring process, let alone getting a job. Can your programming do anything about that? I know engineers who give up and don't even work in the field. They're not just applying in the Bay Area, they're applying throughout the United States. So if you could speak to both of those, that would be great.
So do you want me to go first or you want to do it?
Take it first.
I'll just go very quickly. So first of all, at least the engineers in the semiconductor space, particularly electrical engineers, unemployment rate for electrical engineers right now is, I think, at 1%. I mean, it is full employment. So, we are desperate for talent. I'm happy to have a conversation offline. I don't know whether the engineers you're speaking to have semiconductor skills or not. But we have strategic partnerships with many universities across the country, and that goes from the MITs and Berkeleys of the world to the Arizona states and Oregon states, where in Ohio State now, where we have we have partnerships with historically Black colleges, universities, and other MSIs to help build their engineering and computer science programs, and we hire directly from those, and we sponsor undergraduate research and things like that to really kind of build the talent pipeline. I would just say for technicians, the technicians I've met love the job, right? It's a different lifestyle than I think many other jobs, right? It's like basically they do these rotating weeks where they do 3 days on, 4 days off, or 4 days on, 3 days off. So you get like 3 or 4 days in a row off, and then they work either 36 or like 40 some hours a week in those jobs. They are jobs that we have you know, we're not paying six-figure starting salaries, but we have lots of technicians who do earn with an associate's degree or even less, more than six, I mean, you know, over $100,000 a year. And that's just base salary. You know, with us, you're getting stock options, you're getting annual and quarterly bonuses. So it is a really good life. I mean, we have people with, you know, high school diplomas who are earning over six figures, you know, who are earning six figures.
Yeah, so I'll add to what, you know, David was saying. For us, in terms of what does a career look like, you have your technician pathways, you've got your engineering pathways. But, you know, holistically for us, for to attract this next generation of talent and to also be able to get folks who are looking to transition from an industry to come to Micron, you know, we want to make sure that, you know, the jobs that are available at Micron are skill-based. And so not necessarily looking at the levels of degrees of what folks have, but to be able to make sure that the skills can easily translate to work at Micron. So for example, you know, we've been really successful with this with the veterans community, where we have about a 2 times higher national average in terms of hiring veterans than kind of other tech companies as well. And so being able to attract those folks, not only because they align with, you know, the skill set that we have, but also the values that Micron has and, you know, the values that are aligned throughout the entire semiconductor industry as well. We also are able to utilize our existing footprint to be able to have folks have the opportunities at different fab locations across the U.S. A great thing that we'll be able to do is having our fab in Manassas, Virginia, our R&D site, and our new manufacturing fab in Idaho, and then also our 4 fabs that would be in New York, having the ability for folks to go from site to site and to be able to learn the different aspects, both from the kind of legacy fabs to the leading edge as well on both the R&D, and then also our international footprint as well. And so we have that ability, you know, we are looking at this as an opportunity to be able to ensure that we, you know, allow more folks to be a part of the semiconductor industry, but also, you know, making sure that we're, you know, as we create, you know, the 50,000 jobs in New York, the, you know, 17,000 jobs in Idaho, looking at it from a regional approach, you know, Intel will be has made announcements across the country as well. So has other folks in the semiconductor industry. And so we know it's going to need to be an all hands up approach that we'll be able that, you know, we need to think about things as regional, both Northwest, Northeast, and, you know, making sure that we're incorporating, you know, everyone to be able to be a part of this industry. And that's going to be, you know, us working with localities like the ones you're a part of and the institutions as well, to be able to make sure that we are attracting talent early on, and then also making sure that you know, we're addressing and having and equipping the skill sets necessary to come and work into the industry.
Fantastic. The next written question is from Gail Patterson-Gladney, Van Buren County Commissioner in Michigan. Where do materials come from for the semiconductors? Are they recycled after use? I do not know much about the semiconductors, but I'm willing to learn more. Where do I educate myself and community members about programs?
Can we go to David for that? And we'll start with David.
If I had the answers to those questions, I'd be happy to answer them. I am the workforce policy lead, and so I don't know about our materials. And I just not, I'm happy to let Bo try to take it.
Yeah, so from a supplier standpoint, you know, there's going to be material suppliers, there's going to be, chemical suppliers that'll be needed for the semiconductor industry to be successful. A huge part of that will be, you know, how successful are we going to be, the Microns, the Intels, the Samsungs, the TSMCs of the world, of making sure that we're investing in building up these fabs that are needed to manufacture folks, and then ultimately the suppliers will need to be able to kind of co-locate around us, and also make sure that we're equipping those talent, those folks that are going to be at, you know, all of our fabs, and we'll need all those suppliers, both chemical and material suppliers, to be effective. And so, you know, those folks are constantly, I'll speak for Micron, but I think this is probably true for Intel as well, will be at our fabs throughout the duration of our construction phases and as we get chips out the doors. and are important to kind of continue to make sure that we have the leading edge chips that are coming out of our facilities. So, you know, happy to, there's a supplier page on Micron's site that you're more than welcome to visit to kind of learn about the suppliers that we've been doing webinars both kind of regionally and throughout the state as well, to be able to, you know, talk to folks about what's going to be needed as we kind of implement our two projects, our two investments in the U.S.
Thank you. I'm going to take a question from Eno Modisser, who is an executive health officer in the health department in Brockton, Mass. If you can unmute yourself.
Good afternoon. I am posing this question perhaps to Bo or to David or anyone. I wonder if, how do you see AI affecting hiring human subjects, maybe not now, but maybe 2 to 5 years down the road?
Is your question, sorry, if you don't mind, you know, is your question about AI in the hiring process when it comes to screening applicants, for example, or do you mean AI, you know, potentially replacing?
I mean, replacing human labor force.
Yeah. Well, let me just say that. I mean, I think all of the semiconductor companies see AI as a value add, right? You know, these are very designing and manufacturing semiconductors is the most difficult human endeavor on the planet, or among them, right? I mean, it is the most complicated process there is. So to the degree that AI can help us perfect chip designs, perfect software and coding that goes with those, you know, discover flaws, those things, you know, those are absolutely beneficial to the industry. You know, at this point in time, we don't foresee really supplanting, our employees, right? I mean, you need workers again. Fabs, right? Again, every factory, I just pointed out, creates at least 1,500 to 2,000 jobs. A lot of the work that's done in the fab is already automated, right? You have robots to move the chips around, the lithography tools, themselves, the etching tools, the chemical layering, you know, all of that happens basically automatically. The work is for people, right? That is all about maintaining that process, troubleshooting, discovering flaws, tuning the machines. I mean, that work will continue, right? We're not at a point where that work gets supplanted anytime soon. I don't know, Bo, you want to add anything?
Bo, do you want to add anything to that?
I agree. I think the economic impact and the jobs that we've relayed on the figures for our investments in both Boise and New York, we anticipate to, remain the same, and to make sure, and we know that, AI is an important thing kind of moving forward in the semiconductor industry, and for Micron particularly, memory chips are going to be important for AI and in that conversation, but really believe and have seen, throughout the globe, the economic and impact that's been made from the investment of the semiconductor industry in terms of jobs, both direct and indirect jobs, and believe that will continue.
Great. So we have a written question or comment from David De Gregorio, who's an administrator at Tenafly High School and also is a councilman in Englewood Cliffs, and he wants to work with you all. He's responsible for engineering and design, so I will share his contact information with you all after this. We have raised hand from, we'll go next to Senator Javier Loray Cervantes.
Hi, my name's Anneli. I'm actually the district director representing Senator Javier Lora Cervantes from the state of Illinois. First, I'd just like to say thank you to everyone who did come out today, because I know this is a sort of the first step in taking initiatives to our curriculums, to our districts. We did discuss a lot of education, and I just had a quick question, especially for New York and sort of your approaches to discussing with principals how to bring these initiatives to the schools. When you essentially decide which districts to sort of work with, what does that approach look like? Do you sort of target low-income communities, ones that just kind of tend to work more vigilantly with your company, or just sort of what's the approach that you take when you want to bring these initiatives and change of curriculums to the districts in New York?
Yeah, so it's been kind of an all hands approach. Obviously, we want to make that sure that we are investing in the community in which we are going to be at, but know that especially in New York, it'll be a kind of an all hands and all state effort, both kind of central New York where we're located, downstate in the city, and then also in Albany and Buffalo and Rochester, and really all encompassing approach. And so, you know, we both work with the New York State Department of Education, our local K through 12 superintendents and school systems, to be able to make sure that we're identifying and sharing exactly what is needed in terms of curriculum development, but also how are we spurring the interest of to make sure that we're getting a diverse set of employers and workforce. Not only to be interested in the semiconductor industry and working directly for Micron, but also for the suppliers and the other indirect jobs that will be associated with Micron that are going to be important for Micron to thrive and succeed there. And so it is working with kind of everyone and identifying in New York, you know, a handful of places right now that we can have a prototype, and knowing and then expanding and knowing and understanding that this project is going to, you know, take a couple of decades to make sure that we're to make sure that we are implementing our project correctly, both kind of in New York and then also in Boise. And so knowing that it'll expand and the partnerships will expand as well.
Irina, are there any more questions?
Yes, we have a question from Ernest Abergar. Who is the, the research specialist at Oklahoma Department of Commerce. How can suppliers to semiconductor manufacturers participate to provide educational or practicum opportunities to those areas that don't have a major fab facility nearby?
David, do you want to take a first shot at that?
Sure. Yeah. Look, I mean, we have suppliers in every state in the union and the territories as well. So, you know, we partner with our suppliers in many different ways. You know, we work with the suppliers to, you know, to grow their businesses, to improve their practices, to, you know, ensure compliance, right? And we work with them also on workforce, development strategies as well. You know, we do that. A lot of our suppliers are co-located or near located to our facilities, but a lot of them are not, I guess most are not. And so we are happy to partner them on these efforts. Again, we're happy to share, you know, the curricula, the modules, the things that we have designed in partnership with the schools that have been our partners, right? We're happy to share that with other educational institutions. So if there's, curricula or something that you want to take or modify, or expand on in Oklahoma, you know, we're happy to assist with that.
Great, Bo, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, no, I'd share that too. I mean, I think anything that you're doing in Oklahoma or any state in the country, if you're focusing on, you know, education and investing in semiconductor education, if you are focusing on, you know, incentives for suppliers in certain states and are looking to attract that part of the industry, I think, you know, we'd be happy to talk to you and figure out how we can kind of partner together in states that we are currently investing in for the manufacturing side, but understand that, you know, we'll need to also work with other states to make sure that we have the suppliers and the downstream suppliers that'll be helpful for us to be successful.
So we have one other question that just came in from Council Member Anita Barton. Do either of your companies plan to get together with any universities in PENA?
I'm not sure I understand that. Diversity is the last part?
Companies plan to get together with any universities in PENA? Maybe Pennsylvania.
I'm thinking that's what it is, yeah.
Yeah, I'm thinking it's probably Pennsylvania.
So I can take that. I mean, we launched our, along with the NSF director and Senator Schumer and our CEO Sanjay and, you know, some of our other leadership team, we were able to launch the Northeast University Semiconductor Network. And there are universities that are a part of that network that are based in Pennsylvania. And we understand that it's going to be a regional approach to be able to attract the semiconductor folks or some the next generation of semiconductor workforce to work at Micron. And so happy to partner in that way as well. And we also just recently launched in Northwest one as well to kind of do the same thing, look at states within our footprint region to be able to make sure that we're attracting the workforce that's needed.
David, are you in Pennsylvania or?
You know, I know that we have been in some conversations with Pennsylvanian institutions. I cannot tell you right now which ones they are because I have not been part of those conversations. But, you know, given our proximity to Ohio, I know that in the western part of the state, there's been some interest. I would just say, again, we are participating with NSF in, you know, ensuring that there is funding available to, you know, schools nationwide.
Thanks, David. So I think we only have a few minutes left, and I'm going to turn to Irina to close this up. But I just wanted to say thank you to, you know, Becky, David, Bo. You guys have been fantastic in sharing information that's going to help, I think, across the entire United States thinking about semiconductors and the need to build this pipeline and get excitement around this. And I'm really excited to hear about some of the programs you all have going on. So thank you so much, Irina. I'm going to turn to you to close us out here. But thank you so much
for doing this. Yes, and thank you all. This was a great hour discussion. We appreciate you taking the time and for all the great comments and questions. We will be sending out links to the resources that were mentioned, and we will go back to Becky, David, and Bo, and Sherry for anything else that they want to include, along with a link to the this webinar and the transcript. And as always, we encourage you to visit cfr.org, foreignaffairs.com, and thinkglobalhealth.org for more expertise and analysis. And you can also email stateandlocal@cfr.org to let us know how CFR can support the important work that you are doing in your communities. So thank you again for joining us today. We appreciate it.